And in such a way that, for starters, the president appoints and removes the statistician general, and the relationship ends there. It's like the relationship of a snake and a child. The day a snake is born, they separate their relationship. You never meet again unless you meet in the forest. And of course, the minister and the president is responsible for managing the statistician general's performance and everything, and appoints the statistics council. And here is the trick about the statistics council. It doesn't work like the board. The statistics council advises the statistician general and the minister at the same time. And if the statistician general receives advice that he cannot implement, he has to go public. He must come inform parliament and inform the public. And the council can do the same. And it's the same with the minister. It has never happened that there have been a disjuncture in that sort. I think there's a lot of civility. It was once in 2005 where council and state the same with different fundamental on issues of methods. But that shows the independence of the statistician general. The statistician general is responsible for official and other statistics, while the council only focuses on official statistics. And when we talk about official and other, we are saying that generally we have poor statistics. We have acceptable statistics. We have quality statistics and official statistics. The crime statistics released by the police are not official statistics. They are just quality statistics, because as statistician general, I sign a quality statement after they have met prescripts of a certain quality. The mayor of Johannesburg releases from time to time crime statistics. They haven't even entered the space of quality statistics, because the statistician general hasn't actually looked at those numbers. So they form part of what we call acceptable statistics that anybody out there can release. And the risk of that is that if there's no quality statement, the methods could differ. Someone could, especially with crime. Usually, crime committed, reported at police stations, as we see in the crime statistics of SARS, is not enough. That's why always, as let us say, we go and do a victims of crime survey. And we see it a lot, especially with gender-based violence. When we want to talk to women, you will hear a man saying this, that because we separate them, we want to talk to the victims. We separate them and say we want to talk to everyone over the age of 16. And then when we start asking questions, you will hear the man in the household, the head of the household, who's man, say, no, you must answer those questions. But there is nothing like that. We maintain our independence, and we do take people to court if we don't appear with our way. But we'll come with that. Now, we are usually asked about whether we can do input statistics. We don't do input statistics. What we do is that, let's look at housing, for example. The budgets and the people who work to build houses are your input. The number of houses that you produce in a program are the output. And the processes of building are process indicators. The output are the number of houses. The outcomes are the number of people who access those houses. And the impact is the changes in the life circumstances of those people who have actually gone to access those houses. So the role of statistics is largely at the work of outcomes. That's where we measure. That is why we don't delve into policy. Sometimes we get asked, what do you think, since the GDP has behaved like this, what is your advice, Mr. Statistician General? I gave like my Sangoma and Tawelinga, in case you don't know how I became Statistician General. I can tell you are being bewitched, but I won't tell you who is bewitching you. So that's how far it goes. So I don't get into policy. The role of the policy space and impact is for those in the policy space like yourselves. What you do is you issue a statement. And once you issue a broad statement, what occurs is that then we go and measure. But we are not policy makers. We don't even have the mandate to draw policy. Now, the policy space is the what? Is the remit of those that are in the policy space. Largely, the policy space is shaped by government, because once political parties have had their discussions That's why it's critical for political parties to give all their input and eye to every matter, because those become policies that must be implemented. And once we know we are dealing with a triple scale of poverty, unemployment, and inequality, then we go and measure. We deal only with the how to measure, the methods. That's what we deal with. Let us look at the demographics of South Africa. And this number is going to change. Statistics South Africa releases, look at the economy. Every quarter, the economy is very sensitive. Commander-in-Chief, the economic freedom fighters must always follow the trends in the economy. And I will come and show that later. But the point is here, the economy is so sensitive. That's why we measure it every quarter. But the population is not as sensitive. So we release media estimates. So end of July, we are going to release a new number. The one that we are giving is what we have now. But there's nothing like I could whisper. Myself and the Commander-in-Chief have a history together in our coming up and shaping our lives. But there's nothing like meeting and whispering to you, please know this number. Or since Babam came with the minister in the presidency, is my minister, we meet in a corner and I whisper numbers. So I usually say, don't look at my smiles. Don't read anything in my face. I have no taste buds. So the population of South Africa as of July last year is 57.73 million. Out of those, 14.72 are in Gauteng, 11.38 are in KwaZulu-Natal. Now, the Western Cape and the Eastern Cape are the two provinces that follow, but the Eastern Cape and the Western Cape just keep interchanging like this. And I will talk about that. Why is the Eastern Cape not unseating the Western Cape? They keep on exchanging. Firstly, is that 44% of the population of South Africa is in Gauteng and the KwaZulu-Natal. And the Eastern, when you have the Western Cape and the Eastern Cape, you account for about 60%. So if you ask me, if I were someone who wants to win elections and govern this country tomorrow, I would say this is where the population is moving. I must follow them where they are. But that's not, I can't say that. Yeah. Now, what is happening is that Limpopo is losing the highest number of its productive age young people to Gauteng. Between 15 and 49 years, I'm one of them. And many here. The Eastern Cape is losing a lot of its people to the Western Cape. But there's a difference. The Eastern Cape, the fertility rate, and when we use fertility rate, we don't use men. Men are never a reliable indicator as to how many children are. We use women. The Eastern Cape has the highest levels of fertility. The number of children born of a woman in the Eastern Cape is higher. That's why the Western Cape, even when there are a lot of people coming to the Western Cape, it can be unseated. In Gauteng, the fertility rate is the lowest. The people of Gauteng are so lazy. They are not. In the Northwest and Gauteng, we have the highest number single generation and single person households than anywhere else. Whereas in the rural provinces like Limpopo, Eastern Cape, you have skipped generations. When we talk of skipped generations, is where parents are not there. The children are remaining with the grandparents or great-grandparents. And there are a lot of problems. We will pick them up later as we are presenting. And then the gender balance in South Africa. All the other provinces have more females. Generally, the structure of South Africa is that 52% of the population of South Africa are female. 48 are male. True. When women don't have power, it's not because the Statistician General is not telling the truth. It's other issues. But the reality is, women are higher in proportion. But generally, only in Gauteng, where you have more men, because these are migrant workers. They come and work there, and of course, as they work there, they leave their families back home in different provinces. Now, let us look at the whole issue of the population group in terms of the structure of South Africa. And it's quite interesting. Look at down there, the Northern Cape and the Western Cape. That's where you have the colored population. And the white population, you find them more in Gauteng, the yellow part. If you see the yellow part there, it's where you find the white population more in Gauteng and the Western Cape. But the Western Cape has the highest concentration of white people. Actually, in one of our data structures, we see them as they start growing older, they even leave Gauteng and come and stay in the Western Cape. But the difference is here. The older black people, the black African people, because as in black as in Indian, colored, and African, your Africans, when they are older, they leave Gauteng to go to the Limpopo, Eastern Cape, and KwaZulu-Natal. And then the whites go to the Western Cape, but there's a difference. The whites, when they go to the Western Cape, is to enjoy their life in retirement. The blacks, when they leave to go to rural provinces, to go and die. They overweigh the system, and very soon, because you will see by the life expectancy, the life expectancy of the Western Cape is actually its highest. Now, the structure of Gauteng is showing something. Let's look at the population structure of Gauteng. Usually, you should have a pyramid broad at the bottom and a lot more thinner at the top. But the one of Gauteng, you can see it's actually broader in the middle. It shows you that there are people who are coming in, they are not born there, because when you look at the bottom, there are not so many children born. But somehow in the middle they are there. So they actually move into Gauteng. But one of the things that we have picked up in the next slide is that Gauteng, if you look at Gauteng, it's much more green there at the top. The darker green of the green, you have two greens, there's a darker green, that is your local people who are moving into Gauteng. The lighter green is your foreign people. Foreign people, 50% of people arriving in South Africa choose Gauteng as their destination. They go to nowhere else. Even when they arrive in Mosten, from Mozambique to the Limpopo, Mpumalanga, they say, yeah, true. Yeah. They go nowhere. So if you look at the bottom part, the Eastern Cape and Limpopo, even with foreigners moving into the Eastern Cape and Limpopo, they are not able to offset the losses that these provinces are experiencing. The next slide talks about fertility. Fertility, if you look at fertility, the Eastern Cape, Limpopo, Northwest, and Northern Cape, and Mpumalanga and KwaZulu-Natal, in that rank, are actually the ones with the highest fertility above the national average. If you look, there's a dotted line there. The dotted line is the national average. Look at Gauteng, look at the Western Cape, they are not children. Even in winter, the children are not born. There is a risk. Let me take off the jacket, it's getting hot. And I'm sorry if I disappoint, that's the only thing I'll take off. But the reality is, If my wife and I are two people and we have two children, the moment your fertility rate is at 2.1, you are actually at replacement. So my wife and I are two, we have two children, we have just replaced ourselves. That is why places like Germany, Japan, and Britain are having a lot more problems today.
Yeah.
They have more problems. When we hear in Japan that they are building robots, they are not building robots for animals because they love technology. It's because they are not people to do the work.
Yeah.
So they want to create machines that will do work.
Yeah.
So that's the challenge. And of course, at the stage, we see a proliferation of people from Africa, especially from Northern Africa, crossing into the Mediterranean, risking their lives, and they are even blocked. But the sad part, and I'm going to come to the next slide, but the sad part is that when they arrive, at the nearest point is Spain. When they arrive in Spain, they get sent back. But nobody tells the truth. Spain was a province of Africa during the Carthage Empire, during the first and the second Punic Wars of 204 to 218 to 203 before Jesus was born. Spain and the Roman Empire was a province of Africa, but we are sent away. It's like we don't belong here. So who colonizes who colonizes? But let's leave that. Let's talk numbers. The next slide tells us about the whole issue of life expectancy. Look at the Western Cape and Gauteng. They are above the South African average. Women tend to live about 6 years much more longer than men on average. Other than the fact that they mean they even live longer. Look at the Free State and KwaZulu-Natal at the bottom. They have the lowest life expectancy. For men in the Free State is 55 years and 62 years for females. Let's not scare elderly people when we go out there and campaign and we say, no, now that you have 6 years, you have gone beyond the life expectancy. Because life expectancy is an estimate, and we monitor it every now and then to see how it's shifting. But it's an indicator of how your health systems are working right from birth to death. Generally, there are more boys born than children. There are 102 children, boy children, born to every 100 children born. But what happens is that boy children between ages of 0 to 5, they die in large numbers because they are not as strong as girl children. And after that, between ages of about 13 to 24 years, they engage in risky behaviors. That's why in the Western Cape and in the Northern Cape, the number of young men who are dying is usually due to violence than anywhere else in the country. Now, let us look at employment outcomes. Employment outcomes. South Africa, like many other nations, has adopted what we call a narrow definition as for purposes of employment. So whenever the statistician general comes out and says, unemployment is sitting at 27.6%. It's because we are talking of the people who are looking for employment actively. So you have to be looking for employment for 4 weeks in a row and for 4 days a week, the 4x4 rule. So that 6.2 million is actually the number of people who are looking for employment every day of their lives. The 16.3 are those that are hired. So about 25 years ago, we had 8 million people who were hired. Now we are sitting at 16.3 million. But the reality is that our unemployment is not declining. Over the last decade, it has actually started from around 24, and every quarter when we release the numbers, it's rising and rising and rising. But these are people who are looking for employment every day. But there are others. Look at how many are discouraged. They don't form part of that 27.6%. 3 million of those. So in the next slide, let's go to the next slide. In the next slide, we show you the official definition, which is adopted by South Africa and many nations for purposes of international comparisons. We say 6.2 accounts for the 27.6 million. But the number of people who are unemployed at the 6.2 million, plus the 3 million who are discouraged, plus another 900,000 who didn't look for employment for other reasons other than being discouraged. And we look at people of ages 15 to 64 years, and I usually get with the Mr. Statistician General, why do you include people of 15 years when they are supposed to be at school? The Basic Conditions of Employment Act says that it's illegal to hire any person of 15 years or of less than 15 years. In retrospect, it says that a person of 15 years and above, if they are not at school, they should look for employment. So those that are at school, we actually separate them, we don't account for them. When they say I'm at school or I'm too young to work, we leave them and keep them at school. But the moment they're, and many of them are there on the farms, if you don't meet them in the street, don't assume they are not there. They are there. So now, including the discouraged work seeker and the others who are looking for employment, we have 9.9 million people who are not working in South Africa. About 10 million people. So out of 57.73 million, you have about 20% of the population not working, and in employment terms, because we look at the working age, it's 38%. So we say 38% of the country is unemployed. Program director, at any given moment when you want me to stop, feel free to stop me. I will summarize. Yeah, thanks, Commander in Chief. Now, look at the official and the expanded definition. This is a tricky one. Usually, you will hear the province of Limpopo saying we have the lowest unemployment rate. There's a catch. Look at the lowest bottom. The lowest bottom, the blue part is the Limpopo. It is got the lowest blue part than any other in the country, meaning that its unemployment rate is lowest. And for the past 10 years, it has always been hovering between 18% and 20% unemployment rate. But look at the Western Cape. I want to compare the two. In the Western Cape, the blue color is the lowest, but the yellow color that moves after it is small. It means in the Western Cape, you have a lesser number of your discouraged work seekers. So in Limpopo, look at the brown color. It widens. You have more people who are no longer looking for employment. They wake up every morning, they are seated. And look at the Eastern Cape at the top. Eastern Cape has the highest unemployment rate as in official, the blue one. It also has the highest in terms of the expanded definition. And these people who are waking up and are seated every day, especially the younger ones aged 15 to 24, I'll come to that slide, but let me deal with this first. The younger ones, they wake up and sit, and you don't know what's happening. Nyaupe, there's a lot of sex in there. So if you ask me, teenage pregnancy and a lot more social challenges for care writing, because the parents are not at home.
Yeah.
You will forgive me for talking about things like sex and but I have to talk about these kind of things. Now, what is happening? The biggest challenge here. Look at the rural provinces, look at Limpopo, look at KwaZulu-Natal, look at the Eastern Cape, look at Mpumalanga. They all have a larger brown than ever. And this is a policy space, the policy issue. The apartheid city space is still so prevalent in South Africa. So the reality is that it takes people in rural provinces go very far to go and look for employment, because employment is nearer than the cities. And one thing we should never forget, the poor always follow the rich. So wherever the rich, you will hear that why are people establishing next to Sandton or next to Redbank? And when you drive on the N14, it was first at Dix Road and the Olivet Road Gorge. But as you are driving, you see people establishing on either side informal settlement. Informality, other than being a statistician, I studied town and regional planning, is part and parcel of developing nations. You can keep it lower, you won't put it out altogether because people look for a better life. You always wonder, why are people in Alexandria always establishing their houses next to the river where it's too dangerous? It's because people are smart. They say, I'll put my house there. When it's dangerous, government will come and remove me and give better housing. So the poor always follow the rich. That's why it's not possible to go to my village where I come from and find informal settlement. What are they following there? The next slide tells us something. Younger people, aged 15 to 24 years, their unemployment rate is the highest, 55.2%. Actually, it's about the 31% for graduates. It's even, for those with less than a degree, it's 58.4. Just focus on those 15 to 24 years on the left-hand side. So, younger people, because of inexperience and everything, they are actually affected the most, even when they are educated, even when they are graduates. There's one slide we didn't bring here. That slide shows that when you are 20 years and younger and have no degree or have no grade 11, your chances of getting employed to get income is very low. To get, you have 68% of not getting income. But when you come to 6 years, it starts dropping, even for graduates. So you have young people aspiring to grow old every day so that they can get to there. Some in other countries, people aspire to grow old to gain wisdom. Yeah. In our country, people aspire to get old because when you are earning 400 rand for a child grant and you want to earn 1,400 from them, what do you aspire to grow old every day? Now, let us look at the next thing we bring down in terms of gender as well as population group. Your unemployment rate for your black African women is amongst the highest. So black African women are affected the most than any other women in South Africa. So are colored women. The Indian population is actually catching up with the whites, not only with unemployment, beating unemployment, but even with education. Coming out of the 1930s in one slide we didn't bring here, the Indians have actually moved steadily and are catching up with the whites. Your biggest challenges remain for your Africans as well as your colored population. When I was growing up, I used to know that this thing called drugs were a white problem. But these days when we talk about drugs, we talk young Africans or colored society. It was never an issue. So we have much more problems. And when we look at income as well, we didn't bring this slide. The income of whites is 444,000, and their expenditure is 345,000. They have a gap of 100,000 on average per household that they use as disposable income to go on holiday and everything. For your Africans, their income is 92,000 on average. Their expenditure is 67,000 rands, so the other the disposable income is 30,000. And when you add black tax of Manara Khadi and everyone who comes, then they remain with nothing. So that's the challenge. But let us look at the next slide of young people not getting employment, education, and training. Young people not getting employment, education, and training. Firstly, young people of ages 15 to 24 in South Africa, before we check where they are, there are 10.3 million of those. 3.4 million of those 10.3 million are not in education, employment, and training. They wake up and sit every day. If you don't believe me, I do field work. So I don't sit in Pretoria. I go out in the Northern Cape, in the Eastern Cape, everywhere in the country. You go to Tembisa during the week, you will find people roaming the streets. They have nothing to do. And youth formations in the country take up to the age 35. So when you take those that are aged 15 to 34 years, there are 20.3 million. Of those, 8.3 million are not in employment, education, and training, and they account for about 40% of young people, and the majority of them are in the instant aid. Let's look at poverty. Let's look at poverty. As regards poverty, let's look at the middle circle. The middle circle is the one that the country has trained itself on. If you look at the NDP, and the NDP is actually has gotten buy-in from across the nation, nationally, across all political parties. It says our lower bound, before I come to this, look at the NDP. The NDP says, by the year 2020, I should have mentioned this matter when I come to unemployment. By the year 2020, unemployment would be at 14%. We are sitting at 27.6. So there is no way we can come to 14%. It says by 2030 we must be at 6% unemployment. So there's a lot of work to be done by this nation. There's a lot of work to be done. Now, when you look at poverty, we want to be hunger in poverty. But the middle second is the one that the NDP says we actually manage the lower bound poverty line. The lower bound poverty line says 40% of the population is poor. Actually, it was even lower. It was at 38.6. It has just risen between 2011 and 2015. So people are much more poorer than they were in 2011 and where they are in 2015. And not only that, those who have to decide every day when they wake up and have to decide whether they have to make major decisions, whether they will have food or not, is 25.2%. Those we call them below the poverty line. They wake up if they use their last 10 rand. And if those people are in KwaZulu-Natal, Limpopo, Eastern Cape, Northwest, and they are far away from the cities, they are not going to take that money and go and look for employment. That's why unemployment is the discouraged rate seeker is high. They have children crying in their arms. They rather make sure the children get food. So, and there's a catch here. The catch here is, with poverty, we have only lowered, and let's go to the next slide. Now we are demonstrating how the lower bound is. Look at 2011. We were going down from the year 2006, 2009, 2011. Look at 2015 in the next line. It's rising steeply, so poverty is coming back. But there's even a catch. The catch is, you will not get new poverty numbers. At the stage beyond 2015, we do not know as a nation how many people are poor. Not because we didn't do our work. The nation doesn't have the money to fund programs for poverty. Because poverty is an index. You must do it from the income and expenditure survey side and the living conditions survey side. And as long as the country doesn't have money, or the statistician doesn't have money to fund the programs, the statistician general is not going to go to Limpopo and get money to fund programs. That's it. So this one is rising and we will not know. And even if we were to measure today, it would take us 3 years to come up with an index. And it's biting us. Let us look at the provinces. All provinces are rising. If you look, they show a steep decline. Look at all of them. Limpopo, everyone, they're going down. From the most poorest in Limpopo, Eastern Cape, KwaZulu-Natal, Northwest. You can see the poorest, the rural provinces are poorest. But as they decline, look there, they're starting to rise. There's a tip going up. It shows that in all the provinces except Mpumalanga and the Northern Cape, poverty is steadily rising. But if you come to me and ask me how many people are poor, what is the percentage, I'll tell you in 2015. You say, but give me 2019, I'll always say 2015. You know the story of Mulan. Mulan was looking for a coin under a lamp. And they asked Mulan, where are you looking for a coin under the lamp? What is, did you lose your money there? He says, no, I didn't lose it. So why are you looking for it there? He says, that's the only place where there's life. The only numbers I can say safely is 2015, I will not go beyond. Let us look at the next slide. This one is very interesting. I want us to look at Msinga. Msinga was the poorest was the district in 2001. You can see in the background since 2001. Now look at the boundaries. Each province has a color. Blue is the Eastern Cape, red is the Western Cape, green Northern Cape, yellow Northwest, gray. So those, we have actually put them in the form of boundaries. Now let us look between 2001 to 2011. Look, Msinga was sitting at 60% headcount poverty. Now it dropped by 20 percentage points to about 37.5. Move again from 2011 to 2016. Look. Insikayetu has now overtaken Msinga. And look at the bubbles. But I want to go back to 2001. Please go back to 2001. Because now we should no longer look at the bubbles moving. Because headcount poverty talks about the number of people that are poor. If the bubbles move in a slope, in a straight line, you are only reducing the number of people who are poor. You are not winning the war on poverty. If it starts dropping down to this corner here, to right here where there's a zero here, if it starts dropping down, that's when you are making an impact. So usually I hear policymakers, the premier of Limpopo says to me, Mr. Malude, but we are doing everything. But why are the people who are poor still protesting? I say, Mr. Premier, it's because you have reduced the number of people who are poor. But those who remain poor still feel poverty the same. The intensity, they still feel it the same. So now let us look at the bubbles out there, not when they move in a straight line. Look at the red one, the city of Cape Town. Look, go again from 2011. Look at the city of Cape Town. It's the only one that is actually fighting poverty much more than any other part in the country. Because the red bubble is moving. And they have advantages, their unemployment official and expected is low and everything, so they have their advantage. But the others, look at the blue, for example, in the Eastern Cape, go back, for example. Look at let us look at the Eastern Cape, instead of moving, it's even rising, the blue dots are moving upper. So those who are feeling poverty, the intensity is even going higher. So that's a serious challenge. The 10 poorest districts in the country, municipalities, are located in the Eastern Cape and KwaZulu-Natal. They are Bizana, Msinga, Nuza, and everywhere, but Mhlabuyane, where my Sangoma comes from, is also included. Now, let us look at the income, the structure of income in South Africa. The structure of income in South Africa, on average, about 59%, that's about 60% of the people in South Africa rely on salaries. You can see the RSA is the bottom gap from Gauteng and Western Cape at the bottom. There is 59% of South Africa. Then remittances is 9%. This is the money that we send to our mothers and aunts and everyone. In the villages. And then look at grants. The yellow one. Look at the Eastern Cape, for example. Look at Limpopo. Eastern Cape has the highest percentage of people who depend on grants. The poorest municipalities are in KwaZulu-Natal and the Eastern Cape. The unemployed people are in the Eastern Cape. And then now they rely a lot on grants. And look at remittances. There's a catch in the remittances. The catch is here. I send money to my parents in Malawi. When I send them money, it arrives there in Pretoria, in Gauteng, it goes to Malawi. When my mother gets the money, she goes to Pick and Pay or whatever shop is there, she buys, and then the money is deposited in the account of Pick and Pay. The central account of Pick and Pay is in Johannesburg. So it left Gauteng yesterday and goes to Gauteng the following day. If a currency cannot circulate 7 times in any locality, it will not make an impact. If you go and buy something and the money moves back to Gauteng, it will not make an impact. If a currency must, in economic terms, circulate 7 times, that's when it makes an impact. So you can see that Gauteng and the Western Cape rely more on salaries than any other part in the country. And people rely on grants. But there's another slide we didn't bring here. This slide says that if you take what do we call it? If you take, you look at plants, they are not sustainable, but they are saving our people. When we look at the number of people who get grants, and the households as well as the persons who are actually saved from vulnerability to hunger, is declining. So the more the grants they get, the more they are not exposed to hunger. Now let us look at annual income per household by province. Look at Western Cape. They earn a lot of money. Almost 223,000 on average. Look at Gauteng, 193,000. Look at South Africa, 188. Even South Africa is an average, cannot match those two provinces. But look at Limpopo, Northwest, Eastern Free State, KwaZulu-Natal, they are at their lowest. This is the average income, household income of people in Limpopo at the bottom, 79,000. So no wonder why they depend in the Eastern Cape and Limpopo, they depend on grants and remittances because the people are not paying much. Now let us look at this. I've already spoken about this one. I just want us to look at the red dot and the green dot. Only the red dot and the green dot. Look at the whites at the top. At the top, the whites are actually earning more. The red is what they are earning. The green is what they are spending. Look at the gap that they have of money after they have spent. When we say expenditure, it's all on all your basic things, food, electricity, housing, everything. So this is the money they remain with, about 100,000 they remain with. You see the 444,000 I was talking about earlier. Look at the Indians. They earn 271,000, 272,000 almost. They spend about 195. They have a gap of about 60,000. Look at the colors. The gap is about 50,000. Look at your black Africans. The gap is so narrow. So that's why if you go on places like the cable car in the Table Mountains here, you will see a lot of white because they have money to go on. But look at the Africans. That's the challenge. And when you go to the previous slide and you check where they are in the Limpopo, Eastern Cape, KwaZulu-Natal, we're much more of a serious problem. Let us look at the drivers of poverty. The drivers of poverty are employment and education. The two of them, if you look at employment, it accounts to 53% as of 2016. That's the red part. 52%. Years of education accounts to 11%. When you combine them, they account to 63%. So for people to come out of poverty before they get employment, we need to give them education. Once you sort out education, they have a chance of getting a bit employed. But otherwise, we will have a serious problem as a nation. Because other issues like lack of assets are not polling as high. Let us go straight to GDP and trade because I need to manage a bit of time. Let's skip this one. Let's go to GDP and trade. We indicated as of the last quarter that our economy slumped by 3.2%. And economy is a very sensitive thing. If you have people on the entry burning trucks, when one truck is burned, the truck is worth a million rand, it's pulling a trailer of goods worth another billion. So when it's banned, everything that occurs in the economy, we will pick it up as a city. So the people who are banning trucks may have their own problems and their own challenges. They are saying we'll ban trucks. But whatever, the only thing that we don't pick up is when I do my own washing at home and I don't pay myself. There's no monetary transaction. If I do gardening at home and I don't pay myself for my son does gardening, there's no monetary transaction. Anything that goes on monetary transaction from electricity, water, services, everything, we are able to pick it up because we can measure it in monetary terms. And as we pick it up, we measure the economy. Now, the biggest contributors to the decline in the economy were mining and manufacturing. And this is where the catch is. The catch is here. Don't look at agriculture alone. look at agriculture, it's got a bigger bar in terms of its growth. It grew negatively. But I want us to look at the right-hand side. The right-hand side says manufacturing contributed negative 1.1 to the decline in the economy. So is mining that contributed negative 0.8. Those were the biggest contributors. Even if agriculture declined, it grew a lot more negatively, but its contribution was less to the decline. So what happens when we look at the economy? We don't look at growth. I usually hear people say, agriculture has grown by 24%, but always the contribution does matter. The contribution does matter. So let us look at the next slide. As regards import and exports. Imports, exports went down because there was no manufacturing. If you are not manufacturing, what will you sell? If you are not manufacturing, or if you are not having enough money, what will you buy from other countries? You buy nothing. And here is a catch. I usually hear my workers sometimes to say, no, we are negotiating, we are actually pressurizing the employer, they will give us 8%, and they go for 3 months without working. That's not how the economy works. The mining companies all over the world, they do what we call stockpiling. So sometimes there's a strike ongoing in the mines, and you find that production is at its lowest, but sales are higher. Because the mining bosses are busy selling. So for 3 months, when you are going hungry and you are striking, they are busy selling. So sometimes we hear workers saying we have gone for 6 months on a strike, but the sales, and we see it in the figures. The figures don't lie. Now that's where the catch is. Now let us look at the next slide. This is electricity. This is coming out of 2000. We have been watching the behavior of electricity. But I want us to focus on the last part there. There is a bit of a tick which looks, it drops a bit and goes up. That were power outages, load shedding in December last year. Load shedding in December last year, from December to January this year, affected mining and manufacturing. That's why the economy went on a steady slump. So unless you sort out the issue of electricity, you will not sort out, because food manufacturing didn't decline. Even employment coming out of food didn't decline. But out of electricity, and municipalities had actually limitations on water. So they would come and say factories must take a certain number of liters per day. And to produce cement bars, you need for buildings, you need water and electricity. To mine, you need electricity. So electricity and to a lesser extent water, we call them utilities in economic terms, were the biggest affectors of this development. Now let us look at how the economy has behaved since 1961. We are saying that there have been 8 recessions since 1961. Now I hear a lot of people saying that, you know, if the whites didn't hand over power to the blacks would not be in power to this day. The white economy was having more problems. They were no longer able to sustain it. Look at the number of recessions. Only 2 in the democratic order. The rest from 1961 were under apartheid. Economically, the apartheid device as a machinery was no longer sustainable. And as a statistician general, when you release you tell the people you have gone on recession, I don't feel the pain. I must always tell the truth. But it's one, you get a call from South Africa, status is amongst the top 5 agencies in the world. So nothing gets discussed on Matters statistics in the world. Even when they are blocking us as Africans, they cannot match the kind of intellect that we have grown in South Africa. Next week, I will be in Paris at the European Statistics Commission. They don't allow Africans to be there, but they invite us because of our own intellect, not because of our own skin color. If there was one skin color, we'd have more African countries there anyway. So the point is, when you release and you say there's a recession, you get calls from your colleagues. And the first question they ask you is that, can we share the numbers? And obviously, they're in the public space, they're not here. Are you sure you're solid? Because when you give the recession, it's a very serious thing. So we don't give the recession very lightly. But I noticed that I give numbers, and numbers must always come out. Let us look at the structure of our economy. This one will really show you. Look at finance, business, services. It's 20% contributing to nominal GDP. The structure of our economy is driven by Shenzhen and Cape Town than any other thing else. Government, even now that we are saying we want to cut down on the size of government expenditure, government is saving a lot of jobs in terms of contribution because it's the next biggest contributor. Those expanded public works jobs, those the public servants that are there in the municipalities everywhere, we are creating jobs. It's number two. And it has been number two since 1994. Actually, I think, let me be sure that that slide will come. It's not here, but I'll talk to you. Manufacturing used to be number one in 1994. Look at where it is now. Manufacturing has dropped to about 13. Look at where agriculture is. Right in the corner there, 2%. Agriculture, so the structure of the economy is very critical. It's critical because it tells us what skills we need. In finance and business services and consultancy, you don't need unskilled workers. You need highly skilled people. Look at the areas, mining, agriculture, which need people that are unskilled. They're actually contributing very less to nominal GDP. And we measure it every quarter because it's very sensitive. Let us look at the structure in terms of provinces. Look at Gauteng. Gauteng contributes to more than a third, 34%, more than a third of the size of the population, the structure of the economy of South Africa is followed by KwaZulu-Natal, followed by Western Cape, Eastern Cape, and all the way. But as of 2017, Gauteng was not growing fast enough. Actually, the fastest growing was the Northern Cape. Now, let us look at the next one. This is where you look at the structure of each province. Look at Gauteng. It's only agriculture and mining that are not very strong in Gauteng. I was addressing the Executive Council of Gauteng on Monday. So this slide that we are sharing here, because public knowledge, nobody has a monopoly of them, we must share them with everyone. I was addressing them. Look at what is happening. But look at agriculture in Western Cape and in KwaZulu-Natal. These are the only two provinces. We say Free State has land and agriculture, it's not showing as strong. But we have a problem. I met with the land bank on Wednesday. According to land bank, when they are doing their projections, climate change is going to beat us in Western Cape in another 10 to 20 years. So Western Cape is going to be bad. The only province that has a highly diversified economy is Gauteng, the other set problems. Now let us come again to provincial national GDP in terms of the size of the economy. That is GDP per capita. Look at the people in Gauteng. Then when you look at the population in Gauteng and what their size of the economy and what they are earning, even when the Western Cape has more income, what it means here is that, remember in the previous slide, Western Cape had higher income. It means in Western Cape, people have higher income, they are less. So money goes to very few pockets. Yeah. In Gauteng, people are more. Even the population of Gauteng is 14.72 million, remember. The population, initially in the slide, I said the population of the Western Cape is 6.62 million. So in Gauteng, even when they earn less, second to Gauteng, the money goes to more people. That's what it means. Let us deal with crime, but let's skip those two slides, Faisal. Let's go to the one. Let's skip this one. Or maybe before we come to this one, I just want to talk about incidents. No, come to that one, incidents of crime. incidents of crime are generally higher. That's where we say we are not talking about reported crime. We are talking about incidents of crime when we talk to the victims of crime. So you will always see our numbers are relatively higher than what SAPS produces. Because SAPS only talks of reported cases. And this is what happens with some police stations. What they do, especially with gender-based violence. When a person goes there and say, no, we fought with my husband, you say, oh, no, there's an office around the corner, come and let's talk. Why do you talk about violence? Why should you have an office to talk about family violence? So, with us, we go and talk to the victims of crime. When we come to a family, everywhere we say, we will talk to the household, but we want to know the people. We want to interview every person. And with gender-based violence, you can't police it. You may have 1,000 vans in one locality, one police. You can only measure it when you ask the people who are victims. So that's why our incidents are higher. But let's go to the Robin graph, for example. Go to the next one. We are saying that over time, there was a declining trend in terms of the percentage of households in South Africa that experienced at least one incident of crime. And as it declines, this is a travesty of the criminal justice system. The incidents are very high, the number of arrests are lower, the number of, the incidents are usually high, 1.5, 1.6 million. You come to about the number of cases reported, it's about 800,000, about a million. You come to convictions, it's about 100,000 there. So, generally, you have a serious problem in the criminal justice system. And generally, our people are saying that, and we'll come to that slide. But let's come to this slide first, where the next one for example, which says, households experience, 54% of the households experience burglary more than any other thing. And I think almost all of us here, whenever we are not at home, when we come back, someone has actually helped them with our food and our clothes and the cell phones of our children. But let us look at the next slide. These are perceptions. The number of people who are saying the percentage of households who thought that the violent crimes have increased during the last 3 years, you can see that generally, those who are saying it has decreased are even more. And that speaks to the next slide. Look at the next slide. The next slide, the people trust the police, the blue line. In 2013, 2014, people trusted the courts more than they trusted the blue line, the police. Look at now. The people trust the police more than they trust the courts. And it's true. What happens? Look at family violence for that matter. Here is a young mother who has been beaten by the partner of the husband. They go to court, they go to report. The police will come and arrest the suspect. When they go to court, the court says there's no evidence. So people trust the police, but the police are the first port of call. So it's actually sometimes disappointing when you have incidents of police that are not willing to wear when the people are giving them much more trust. And because the other thing is that the courts are a technical device. So when you go to court, and I'm not supposed to say this, but justice always lands in the pockets of the highest leaders. But I can't say that. Let's look at living conditions. The statistician general must talk about the next slide. Look at formal dwellings. Formal dwellings have increased from 8 million to about 13.5 from the years 2002 to 2018. And we just use these figures. You can see the data one at the top. Traditional dwellings are declining from 1.2 to 800,000. But look at the informal dwellings, they are increasing. 1.5 million to 2.1 million. In a developing nation, there is no way you can beat informality. So when you plan and deal with town and regional planning, You cannot hope you will give everyone a house. There are people who will say, I will set up my own house and I will work and develop myself. And then let us look at the provinces in terms of Gauteng, Western Cape, and the Northwest are showing the highest number of increase in informal dwellings. Gauteng is because the poor always follow the rich. Western Cape is because of the agriculture. We saw agriculture is very strong and the people are establishing. Northwest is because of mining. Those are the ones that have the highest. The others, Free State and Northern Cape, are just continuing and Mpumalanga is just declining. Let us look at water. Around 14% of households rely on a communal or neighbor's tap as a main source of water. So people don't have what we call piped water in the dwelling or on site. About half the population, they rely on communal tap to push a wheelbarrow to go to the point. But as in piped water in the dwelling, on site, not in the dwelling, in the yard is 28%, and then communal is about 12%, and of course, those who rely on carriers are about 3%. Now, let us look at the average household, the next one that we connected. Gauteng is the only one that is declining in terms of connections of electricity. The others are increasing. Look at the Eastern Cape. The Eastern Cape is even growing the highest because it started from a low base. The Eastern Cape is right above Gauteng. It is growing highest in electricity connection. It's because it started at a low base. But with Gauteng, it's because it's having a lot of households. Look at Gauteng. Between 2017 and 2018, South Africa experienced a growth of households by 472,000. 175 of those households are in Gauteng alone. A third of those are in Gauteng. So everyone is still streaming towards Gauteng. Let us look at the whole issue of access to improved sanitation. Limpopo is a problem. Limpopo is not, in sanitation, it's problematic. And not only that, we ask people, how many of you, when you have used a bathroom or toilet, have washed your hands? The people of Limpopo are the lowest in washing their hands when they use the bathroom. Doesn't matter where I come from. I must tell the truth. Even if I come from Limpopo, I must tell the truth. But the trick is here. If you are bushing facilities in a forest, where will you wash your hands? Because Limpopo has the lowest number of. Go back to the slide. You see this one. It shows you the red one is Limpopo. And why we may put it like it's a point for jovial banter. The reality is it's raising serious health problems, cholera and other issues. So when I presented to the MEC of the ANC about 3 weeks ago, and I went to present to cabinet, I was saying to the newly appointed minister at cabinet that watch the Limpopo. KwaZulu Natal has always had breakages of cholera, but Limpopo is going to give us problems. Now the last slides. I just want to share with you, because as leadership, you need to know what has happened. You cannot be leadership and you do not know what has happened. There was a lot of noise in the elections recently. This is not, we don't generally do this well, but we get asked, as Stella said, to express opinion. One time, RTMC, what are those people who deal with road management, traffic control? Yeah, they called us to say, come and assess our numbers. And we looked at the numbers and we said, your numbers don't make sense, so we cannot express an opinion. It's because if two people have an accident in a vehicle, two vehicles have an accident, the one will go and report at the police station nearest to their home because they don't want to go back to the Eastern Cape to report where it happens. And then it's a case number. The one reports in Gauteng or in KwaZulu Natal, it's a case number. When you start looking, the two vehicles cross reference each other. So that's where the problem is. So we couldn't express, but when there was a problem, the 48 hours from from Thursday afternoon to Saturday afternoon when they said, I heard the media was referring to smaller parties. In my mind, there's nothing smaller. Yeah. I deal with numbers as numbers. So the media was referring to political parties that were saying there was a lot of mass meeting, double voting and everything. But as leadership, you need to know what that's saying. What we did is that we took all the 23,000, 22,000 to 995 voting districts. And we wanted to sample, take a representative sample to understand what happened. And out of those, we found a representative sample of 1,020 voting districts or voting stations. And these ones were represented by province, by ward, as well as lowest to the voting district, so that we can see the behavior of the voting district. And we held ourselves so high, we said we are at 3%. The error we could admit if we made an error would be 3%. We were saying we are holding ourselves to 97% confidence level that the points that we will release, we are solid. Now, we started working on the data when the data that had trickled in was at 52.53%. We received it again at 99.99%, and we received the final 100%. When we looked at them, and there was a problem. The problem was the ZipZip machines couldn't be reliable. Because the ZipZip machine, even if you went 10 times, it would, at the same voting district, it would zip you because it's not linked to a central database. We use Section 24 forms, and this is not the way for statisticians, but when you are given a problem, you must unpack it and reason it out. So we said, what is it that we will use? We said we will use Section 24 forms because nobody would have voted outside their voting stations without filling a Section 24 form. However, there were some parts of the country where voting occurred and they ran out of Section 24 forms. And we wanted to know the procedure. The procedure was that the presiding officer and the political parties had prevailed. The party agents had said, you can't send our people away from voting. They must vote. So we said, on the basis of that, because the political parties that were represented in the voting district, albeit the fact that they were not all, had actually agreed on the fact that the people could vote for the presiding officer to allow them to vote, it's because they had an interest. So the Section 24 form was a safer way to work on than a ZipZip machine. So we took the Section 24 forms. We wanted to look at the number, and we no longer look at the registered voters in a voting station. We wanted only the total number of people who voted, because if you have used Section 24 forms, it means we have more people who have voted than the ones that are registered. Then we said, let us treat every voting district that has more than 50% within its own ward. Because voting district, you can't compare them outside their own ward. You can't compare voting district in Limpopo to one in KwaZulu-Natal. Because that behavior would likely happen in the neighborhood. Those that have more, we want to compare them within their behavior, and we will treat them as suspect. It doesn't mean that there was something wrong, but the extremity would tell us the potential dangers. Then we looked at those that were above the 50% mark. They were about 447. And we looked at those that were above the 75%. There were only 172 of the 1,020, and that represented a percentage of about 17%. And then we went further, we said we want to look at 90%. We divided every behavior in 100 pieces to create what we call percentiles. We went to 90%, we found only 13. And out of these 13, they represented only 1.3%. of the sample voting district. Then we went further for the extremity. We went to 95%, we found nothing. We went to 99%, we found nothing. So we're able to tell the IEC that you can go and release your results. On the basis of the fact that when we go to the extremes of the decision to release is not ours, IEC is independent, we are independent. But we said the fact as we go into the extremities, we are not picking up anything. It shows that because if there was behavior, we would still pick it up in the 90% high and the 90% high. Now the political parties came to us. They said, Mr. Statistician General, we have two voting districts that we are sure that double voting actually occurred. We wanted to include them in the sample. We didn't include them. Because we are independent. The moment we included anything that we had picked up out of the representative sample, it means that we would have suffered undue influence. What would make the public or a court of law believe that we have been influenced by the IEC to take some that would make them bad? And when we went to release the results, we didn't meet with the IEC, we refused. We said we are going to meet with the political parties first and brief them. And we also didn't. Our staff members who were waiting on this went on a 48-hour court because we didn't want contamination. So they couldn't move there. For the last 24 hours, they slept in office, they stayed in office. The IEC offered to give us some registered boxes with the Section 24 forms that we had to take to our station. We said it will cause contamination, we will work with the database, and if we need anything, we'll go to the IEC. So the next slide says in Jinela Kwan, and you need to know about this slide. When I was young, our mothers were illiterate. They couldn't write letters to our fathers who are migrant workers in Johannesburg. We used to write letters for them. A mother would never end a letter by saying, I love you to her husband. Or I miss you, because the children are writing, they are not supposed to hear those things, they will go deaf. They are not supposed to see those things, they will go blind. So the only way a mother would end a letter, even when she wanted to tell her husband the travesty of apartheid, she can't tell the husband I love you. She only could only say the hell of God. That's how a mother would end a letter. But before we go to the next slide, I want to say another slide we didn't bring. It shows that children 0 to 17, 7 to 18 years who are not going to school, 14.4% of those are girls. And these girl children are denied from going to school because of family responsibility. When there's an uncle who is sick or an aunt, they don't go to school because they must look after the aunt. Some of these young girls are looking after children on their own. And now, when they write letters in future to their husbands, because they will not be literate, they will write like this and end it in the hell of the world. I'm afraid the next slide is blank.
Is there a head at the back there? I can't see who's that. let's take Nandi, DP. Is that fine? All right. We'll start with number five.
Thank you so much. I just wanted clarity on how, like, what the relationship is, or what is Spain's case at the end being contributing to the second highest of the GDP, but also having been like the lowest three provinces in terms of poverty, or having experiencing poverty more, like in the bottom three provinces, and how that, how the relationship happens. Thank you.
Number four, Commissar.
Thank you. I would like to, there's a slide I thought you would see, but I'm not sure if the position general can afford us an opportunity to hear in relation to health, in terms of the mortality rate, and he mentioned that children are dying, especially the boys.
Yes.
Now, I would like him to give us information in terms of the mothers who give birth, and beds in hospital with nurses or doctors available in South Africa. That's a population.
It's a very important question, Commissar. Yes. Number three. Thanks. My mind is two questions, but are related to each other. The first one is on the when we see someone is employed, is it based on how much salary before we see someone is employed? And the second one is that how do you classify a person who is a worker in the PWP, the other one is an intern, Zeta, the other one is a shop right worker? Because some of the workers who are said workers, they might also earn less money than those who are called in terms of those are intense. So I'm just saying, I just want to leave that right.
Number two, I'm going to be child concern. Not that even was chairperson, I've got three questions on my side. And I wanted to ask the SG on the effect of the FDI, foreign direct investment, in terms of the GDP in South Africa, because there's some noise makers in the media saying that the formation of the EFF would have led to the decline in the FDI and all those things. And then number two, did you manage to do a excess in terms of the farm killings on your crime slide, just to say in terms how many the violent crimes which are occurring in the farms, and you know, they've actually been amplified by some groups which are noisemakers there in the media. You know, how many farms are they? Quite a lot, and what is your view on that? And then on the third question, that is on your election auditing or your statistical study. Have you thought maybe to do a study in terms of the elections in general, how did they happen from your VD to receiving the results, auditing, and the whole publishing? Because as a political party, we've seen some very strange patterns where we found that maybe some of the votes that were supposed to go to a party and given to another party. So have you done any statistical analysis in terms of the credibility or if the results that have been published overall make a statistical sense? Thank you very much.
Okay, number one, Chair of Gauteng.
Thank you. I have a lot of questions,
but
I'd like to take care of them, because they are quite detailed. Let me limit myself to a couple. My first question is the population of 57 million. Does it include persons who are naturalized in South Africa and also foreign nationals who may have permanent residence, or does it not include them? What is the ratio? sure, have you got a study that can give us information on the population to officer ratio as well as population to professional ratio for medical practitioners, nurses, teachers, as well as police officers and maybe even social workers? I also wanted to understand, like I said, I've got a lot, so let me give you my last two questions. I also wanted to understand what is the growth rate. So we get the population growth, but the growth rate of South Africa's population, how does it compare on average to other countries that are in a similar socioeconomic status as us, or just in general, so that we know whether our growth rate is worrisome or not? And then my very, very last question is, all your figures on income, do you have income stats that, similar to analytical, I'm sure you're familiar with analytical, that can tell us race-based and gender-based income per sector, per the formal sectors of the economy that you indicate? Sorry, if you just indulge with a very last question. The export statistics that you report on in one of the slides, can we get those export stats based on product as well as origin of that product, if it's a finished good? For instance, if it's not, you know, a natural, like it's not a mining product, it's a finished good, can we get a stats on the origin of that product, let's say like the raw material origin of that product, and how much of it was South African, etc. I'll explain it later on email. I don't think it makes sense now. Thank you very much.
Okay. We should have had some principle of one man, one woman, one question. The officials, let me begin with the DSG.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Just one question. Let's talk about 2014-16. And then you mentioned that it's just because of the funding. Who is responsible for that? Is it the treasurer? Or is the university just not take money to fund the project? And then number two, the contributors to the GP. Whereby you mentioned that the government is also contributing 19%. Where do you locate the private sector?
Thank you. SG?
No, well,
okay, you're also here. DP.
That's a D. A number of you are immigration. How many people are in South Africa who are visiting? Not twice. But the numbers are not clear. So you spoke about the majority of people. So how many people are in South Africa? And is it part of the 7.7 million people in terms of what is the plan? So that is so that we then know in terms of how the resource allocation should be done. And if the DSG is raising that, perhaps the state says they should write to all political parties about the poverty index survey so that we can deal with it with appropriate qualities and in the appropriation process. Thanks.
CSC. Okay. SG.
This is the SG, is a statistician. thank you again, Program Director. Let us start with the points that are raised by the Chairperson of Gauteng. The number of people who, and I think the DP also raises some of the issues. Number of people who are in South Africa, and whether we account for the naturalized or not. I guess we are all aware here of the developments taking place in the United States now, where Donald Trump wants to measure the number of migrants in America. And the matter is actually before courts, where they are saying you cannot ask people health status or not, actually, it's going to derail the American census. The American census was first thrown into this array in the 1860s. So what is going to happen now if that person goes ahead? Because statisticians do not decide the what. They only go and measure. If they measure that, they will never know the exact size of the population. Because illegal immigrants, the moment you start asking them about their status, they don't answer questions. And when they don't answer questions, no matter how much sophisticated your system is, they will beat it. If they can, we usually say our borders are very porous, but America's borders are much more stronger than ours. But the people, even they even get the green card, they will beat it. But look at certain centers where we say we know in Sunnyside, in Berea, and everywhere there are more illegal people. If we don't account for them, they will connect illegal electricity illegally, they will get water, and they will need abortion facilities. So you will not be able to plan because those people have withheld their information. So a statistician general or a statistician official practice all over the world accounts for people within the borders of the country without requesting their legality or their legal status. This statement is not lied by the Minister of Police when I say it and those that are in the security cluster. Because they say that you are encouraging illegality, you must ask them. They won't answer. And we will lose out a lot. There's another thing that occurs with that. They partake in production. So the moment they use that, because we measure economy from both sides, from production side and from the expenditure side. The moment they know you are watching them, they will not declare on the side of production. And some of them don't declare. There are a lot of activities happening in South Africa as anywhere in the world. But we are able to pick it up from the expenditure side. This is what happens. Let's say, let me give an example of a drug dealer who manufactures drugs into, say, millions or billions of friends. That drug dealer would never want to be known. So they would manufacture, so you can't pick it up because they don't record it. But they spend. They will go and buy cars and buy housing. So from the expenditure side, you will see. But our job, because we keep a lot of records, other than illegal immigrants, we come to households, all of us are in households here. We ask about personal records. We ask about salaries and earnings. And imagine, not even illegal immigrants, even society thought when we collect information, take it to SARS. People do not want to answer questions. So we have a high level of confidentiality. The DP, when I got appointed, he said he wants to lead, he wants to encourage the commander-in-chief to allow him to lead a delegation to come to Spencer City. And on that day when it occurs, we will take you to our fire server. We don't even allow cameras. It's highly cordoned because data becomes the most critical thing. If you look at the way data is being used, not even personal data, data in the world, the combustive engines are actually fighting your smaller firms, in smaller in terms of their size, but bigger firms like government. Those that use 10 right, 10 left. Because those ones using geographic positioning, they are now starting to want to manufacture driverless cars. And if they can harvest the sun coming out of their solar panels that can recharge rather than relying on the brakes when you are moving, they will actually unseat your combustible engine capacity in the future. So that's why the whole issue of data. So data, and not official statistics, data, artificial intelligence will be the key issues that will drive and control the world. Whoever controls the data in the nearest future will control the world and it will be well.
so it's very critical that the data that we have we hold on to and try to find ways of even harvesting from other sources, but the confidentiality is very critical. The POPI Act is actually coming to kick in very soon. One of the things that we are getting now is you are sitting at home, you get a call, and someone says, no, I want to know if you want to have a house, and you ask them, where do you get the number? They say, we're in the national database of consumers. They are lying. Someone from the bank has secretly walked with a mnemonic and passed on information. Personal information is being sold, and it's used to target the weaker ones or those who are targeted even by systems. So states, powerful states will even target individuals that they find very dangerous to themselves, or even powerful money individuals will target others using data. So it needs to be gathered very secretly. The whole issue of the population in terms of the ratios, how many nurses versus teachers versus the population of children, we don't produce that. And it's because at the beginning I said we focus at the outcomes level. Those are generally at your input level. And because they are at your input level, we call them administrative registers. So we have done censuses of school in the Eastern Cape and in Limpopo to tend to understand the averages. But then as soon as we finished, the two provinces wanted us to give them the data so that they can punish principals that are not performing. And you cannot use official statistics for punitive measures because official statistics will no longer be independent. So we almost dragged each other to court, but we stuck by our guns that the records under our key are actually highly codified. We can release them if there's a court order. We had a case of murder that occurred, and the police came to us and we said, we can't give you records, but the judge compelled us to make those records. And they couldn't even take them away. They could only come and in the process of data, because we take even records from home affairs, that when you seal the B1663 when someone dies, that form doesn't go to home affairs. The home affairs takes it and brings it to status say, we need to know the primary cause and the secondary cause of death. And because these are health issues, and insurances, remember after that, because insurances, their reason is not to pay out when someone dies, it's to justify why they should not pay. So if status say were to find themselves starting to dish out information on personal records, we would actually weaken whoever controls data will control the world. We don't even say where our backup servers are. So we have had a question here in Parliament, and we have backup and recovery. We said yes. Where do we have? We said no. But we know, but we can't say. But now, in terms of race-based and gender-based products, it's very difficult. Let us look at a cell phone when it's being made. You mine cobalt, and when you mine cobalt, when you go to a miner and tell us, in these volumes that you have, where they mine by male or female, they will not be able to tell us. They can tell us what salaries go to women, what salaries go to men, but they won't tell us who has mined. And in the value chain of processing, if you look at platinum, for example, when we deal with the behavior of the platinum metal group in measurement in the economy, we look at it from your mining side of the rock samples. Then from there you go to flotation, and from flotation you go to refinery, and flotation takes a lot of work. By the time you have platinum as a final product, there will be men and women, but you will not know where on which bit. And when you go to consumptions, when people are buying, even all of us as consumers here, if we were asked when we are buying, whether shops must record on the expenditure side, whether we are male or female, we would say they are wasting our time. So we don't measure that, but from households we are able to tell who earns what are the earning levels, we can talk about that. But from production, it's very difficult, including raw materials. Now, I will deal with the issue of poverty. We protocol in terms of we don't write political parties even with our independence. So what we do is in the formal portfolio committee in parliament, we have been raising this thing, but we'll continue to raise it. There has been consent from GCIS as well as from when we were together with the Department of Planning, Monitoring and Evaluation that we are talking about this issue of the lack of funding for states to say publicly. But the point is the statistician general should not hide anything. And the reasons are as follows. Once a series started, once you start having two dots of information, three going forward, nobody can stop a series in South Africa. Not even the president can instruct the statistician general to do so. It's only the statistician general who can stop that series. Because if we allow a series, like the poverty series will be broken. So even if we come back and measure, future generations will not know how we adequately responded to this issue. The other issue that we just did about 3 months ago, I withdrew a gender-based violence report 2 days from publication. Because there are people who we used to have 7 staff members, we are left with one. And she does her best. But when we looked at it from a statistical point of view, it didn't make sense. So we had to withdraw it. And gender-based violence is a serious thing in South Africa. And for the statistician general to say, I'm withdrawing that report. And these people who work at statistics are very strange people. They sometimes don't wash their cups of tea for a full month. Because it's just things like mathematician or mathematician all the time. Now, I had a rebellion the other time where want to resign because they have a professional body esteem to uphold if there's no funding. Now it's a very difficult thing to find yourself. So this thing we heard from the CEO of SABC, there is a problem. So the problems where we are not being funded is from National Treasury. That's where we are not going to be getting funded. The role of the 19% coming out of government, and where's the private sector? What happens is government is clear to delineate. Look at agriculture, for example. Agriculture may be having 2% in terms of the act, because it's the primary sector where it occurs. But you can pick up agriculture in trade. When you go to pick and pay, when you buy vegetables, they are no longer classified as agriculture. They are classified as trade because pick and pay is classified as trade. Look at South African growers, for example. It's got large farms of land where they grow their malt, but they are not classified as agriculture. They are classified as food and beverages. So you see, it's just that the economic classification, the IC for economic classification, we use an international code to be able to compare with other nations. And for that reason, I will not be having statistics of comparisons with other nations in relation to our growth rate. But our population growth rate is growing at 1.56% phase at this stage, about that. But certainly not above 2. Our fertility rate is the one that is at 2.4%. So in terms of the population growth rate, we also include those people that are in the country illegally. The police always say, but Mr. Statistician General, we are not sure how many people are here illegally. And we say, certainly we are not sure, because we use the census as a register which we, for our sample. But trends closer to where the population is, we are able to get. Because when we go to households during our labor force survey and our general household survey, we capture them. Because when we sample, we first don't say, we don't know until we are at your household whether you are South African or not. Whether you are illegal, we only get to know when you are there. But we also ask the person in the census, where have you been in the last 5 years? So that we can deal with internal migration inside the country as well as externally. That's why we are able to say how many are there. As regards tourists, people who are not just illegal migrants, we can actually make those numbers available. And I think in the next 2 weeks, we will be having a media briefing with the latest numbers, but we monitor them monthly. We can actually say that from SADC, the majority of people come from Lesotho, they come from Mozambique, they come from Swaziland and Zimbabwe. But there's a trick. our verse says, you can't come to us if you're a citizen of the Lesotho to say you want a working permit. Come to us and say you are visiting. Because if you want a working permit, you must first prove if there are people in South Africa who can do that work. And we already know that almost every household in South Africa, especially in the urban centers in Gauteng, has a domestic worker from Lesotho. So the point is, the people from Lesotho go there, they classify themselves as tourists. And what we do when we capture, we don't ask them, because we collect the records from Home Affairs and work with them. So those records that we use always say from Lesotho, we are having a lot of tourists, but those people are not necessarily tourists, but we have no other way of dealing with it. From other African countries, we have Nigeria sending the highest numbers, I think followed by Kenya, and followed by Uganda, but Uganda fluctuates, but Nigeria is sending a lot of people who are coming to South Africa. Now, the FDI, Foreign Direct Investment, as regards, we don't measure foreign direct investment. That's the role of the Reserve Bank, because the Reserve Bank deals with balance of payments. Everything that gets paid to South Africa, even if you receive money from a foreign bank, it must be cleared through a Reserve Bank. So what we do out of that is that we measure the expenditure pattern. So we are not able to tell which part is direct, I mean foreign direct investment as said, because we deal with productivity and expenditure, and they deal with balance of payments. But there's also a catch. SARS doesn't have enough officials that deal with customs duties. And we see it in our trade statistics, because whatever we are saying as a country we are exporting to other countries, it's not what they say they are importing, and that gap is widening. It's accepted if it's 5%, but as it starts growing, it starts to worry. So what is happening now is that at SARS, when a person brings merchandise, and the powerful business people go there and they meet the official and say, but you know me, I was here last week, and you will buy them. They just release the and some of the stations where our goods come through, they are not having enough people. There was once a case, but that I will tell outside here, of the British were sending merchandise to go to Iran via South Africa because they say South Africa is a credible system. They wanted us to document it, but it's a long story, and it shows that illicit financial flows and activities still occur in sophisticated markets. Now, the credibility of the work of the IEC, it was a rare event that we dealt with, that we assisted the IEC. We have never done it before. We don't have the capacity at the stage, but one thing that we saw was a problem bigger in the IEC, and I think they will admit and talk for themselves. The ZipZip technology and the technology they are using is old. It's 13 years old, and not only that, it was not meant to interact with the smart card ID. Because, yeah, so when you have technology that is not integrated, if technology doesn't move with time, it actually causes problems. And especially today, in where we are with technology, if we don't move fast, we will be left behind as a country. But if they ask us, we have assisted them many times. The voter registration, when they did voter registration, they didn't have systems that could capture the voter registration. So we signed an MOU with them. We assisted a lot of the departments in the background. We brought the voter registration forms because we have scanners that can eat about 1,000 pages in 1 minute and produce data on the other side. So we do assist them. We are also working currently with the Department of Agriculture. The Department of Agriculture, we are doing a census for them on the commercial agriculture, census of vet-paying agriculture. But they are also registering land parcels all over the country. So we are working with them, but we work in the background. The problem is here. When StatsSA starts working with policy departments and is in the front line, we compromise our independence. So what we do, we send our technicians. They work, they assist them. It's not secret. We make it public. Everyone knows, so that we are not caught in
in a compromising position. But once we assist them, they take ownership, especially with the issue of land now. Because one of the things we have picked up is that when you look, the farmers who we are actually collecting data from, vet pay and prices, when we go to them, they say, yeah, we know we want to support the expropriation of land without compensation. Our job is not to support the policy position. Actually, we have a problem now. I won't mention names because there's a camera there. There are some people that are going to send the police to lock up for refusing to answer questions in some communities where they are saying that we can't answer because SSA is implementing a government position. But as a government, people have, about 72% of people will have double bank accounts, everything. But land is about 2.3, 2.1, and men and female. And what is so critical is that a lot of black people hold parcels of land. Because black people, if you go to them and ask them, but do you have permission to, do you have a title deed? They will tell you, don't tell me a title deed, this is the land of my forefathers. So we no longer ask that question. We just say, you have a piece of land other than the one you are staying on. They say, just rent land. But it, technically, it's only in urban areas where people have title deeds. In the rural areas, it's permission to occupy. But it's land that has been belonging to their forefathers. Employment, as we deal with employment, we work with the International Labour Organization. Firstly, we say you are employed if you are self-employed or if you are employed by someone. If you are employed for purposes of making income. So if you are employed for, if there's a child at home who is waiting, but is not earning anything and is assisting in a family shop, that one is not employed. Even if an adult is not for remunerative purposes, they are not employed. But the moment you earn the wages or a salary, we say you are employed. Mandela, what is the threshold of the number of hours that you need to be employed for? Yeah, so if you work for 1 hour per day, and you may find it odd that why would you call someone who works for 1 hour a day a week? Don't look at it from me and you because we are a lot more poor. Very rich people like George Soros work for 30 minutes a day and they make billions. And they still make their income. So the point is that there's an income disparity. And then as regards health, we will make available those numbers on mortality. I've left the contact with the program director, but we'll make them available. But this is what happens. Mortality, maternal mortality is declining in South Africa. But it's not, so is child mortality. And when we talk about maternal mortality, we are talking about a mother who dies within 42 days of giving birth. So that's maternal mortality. So it's declining, but it's not yet at a number that we have put ourselves. And then if you have the numbers there, please, then you can talk to them right away. Yeah.
Currently, at 2016, it was 108. The SDG target is at 70 by 2030. 108 per 100,000 births.
So what is happening is that it's declining, but we haven't met the target of the end. And it worries, it still worries. We have seen with child mortality, it's even critical. Because the quality of water that people are drinking, the children become very sensitive. Because their food is usually based on water. So sometimes, when there is a problem in the quality of water that they are drinking, we see it in the provinces when there's starting to be a lot of fluctuations in the child mortality. And then, of course, the whole issue of poverty and in relation to the economy and the alleviation of poverty coming from an economic angle. Economy is a very critical issue, and for the fighters here, it's critical that our statisticians are more than, we are, it's not more than me, it's our national duty. Official statistics is not for the monopoly of those that are in government. It's for every one of us. So at any given moment, when there is information you need, don't hesitate even come and train members of the public or any establishment or legal formations to understand the numbers that we produce. Because if we don't understand the way the economy works and the way it deals with alleviation of poverty, we will not be able to beat poverty. Because there's a difference between being an economic freedom fighter in the EFF, because we are talking about the total emancipation of black people, than someone who call themselves Economic Democratic Party in London. They are worried about the money that goes to their pockets. So it's critical that we understand the way the economy structure is and the way it works vis-a-vis the alleviation of poverty. And the census say we will always be available. And we carry this, we're not hiding our point. We say we are independent and we will share our information with everyone. The information we never share is the one that is never published. Once it's published, it's public knowledge and we must share it. I thank you.
Thank you very much. It was a really fruitful session for us as we begin our 6th Democratic Parliament. And I do have the contact details for comrades that have further interest. Chief Whip MDP, shall we release the ESG? Team as